Today we are going to talk about these topics. Number 1, 8 steps towards becoming the leader you need to be to succeed. Number 2, be a leader, not a follower. Number 3, are you a victim of vagueness or a champion of clarity? Number 4, public speaking lessons. Number 5, leadership, one easy thing you can do right away to improve your results. Before we start, remember to subscribe now and share this video to all your friends and everybody. Now let's begin. Number 1, an important part of success in life is the ability to lead. It is important that we not only be able to lead others, but be willing to lead ourselves. No one succeeds in life by simply following others. Sometimes we simply must strike a bold new path for ourselves. Being a good leader is more than simply being at the forefront of the crowd. A leader must act. Too often in America, we simply accept that someone looks or sounds like a leader, and too rarely do we actually look at the actions that leader performs, and that is the true test of leadership. However, in order to become good leaders ourselves, we need to concentrate on actions rather than simple appearances. The title of this article refers to 8 steps, but do not think of these as progressive steps like so many recipes or instruction manuals describe. Instead, think of these as actions that you must take on a regular basis. First, be alert to new potentials. Reality is not absolute but rather subject to constant change. Think about inventors, explorers, and agents of social change who have achieved greatness. Some might simply say that certain people are successful because they are lucky to be in the right place at the right time. Maybe so, but if they hadn't had their eyes open for the opportunity, then it wouldn't have mattered if they were in the right place. Second, accept inspiration from wherever it comes. Even your opponents. The wisest leaders constantly study their competition. In war, politics, and business we constantly see examples of this research and reconnaissance. Too many times though a certain study, many concentrate on finding a weakness to exploit. If you want to be a leader of positive change, don't fall victim to this trend. Instead, if you find a weakness, make sure to avoid that pitfall yourself. If you find the strength, then find a way to strengthen your own qualities to match. Third, learn something new and promote in new ways every day. This means you must continually seek to expand your horizons, internally and externally. Feed your mind with new lessons and knowledge, but constantly expand your social horizons as well. Seek out and meet new people and immerse yourself in new social situations. You never know when these new experiences will help you in your leadership role. Fourth, search for and find answers in subtle clues. Look beneath the surface and constantly question. This is an extension of the third step in that you are seeking new knowledge. But this also means that you will need to step off the traditional paths of knowledge. Don't simply read books in the literary canon or the bestsellers list. Take seminars rather than classes, as there is more room for questioning and debate. Seek out the unconventional thinkers, teachers, and writers. Fifth, improvise if no existing solutions are available. No excuses. Necessity is the mother of invention. How do you know it won't work if you've never tried it before? Remember, not all approaches need to come from the front. Look at your problem from all sides and systematically attempt different solutions in various combinations. Sixth, make at least one person you care about happy every day. If you make it a point to be thoughtful and caring for one person every day, then soon this thoughtful, caring behavior will become a habit, and that habit will spread to the others around you. Making someone else happy also feeds your own personal happiness. Just imagine how much better the world would be if we all did a little bit more to spread happiness. 7. Offer help, even if there is no apparent advantage to you. This means more than writing a check. It means giving of your time and energy and yourself. Sometimes it will mean helping someone you don't know, and sometimes it can be a very personal action. Finally, never let negativity be your last word on the subject. If your final words are negative, then no matter how hopeful you may be about the potential of a project or action, the lasting impression you give to others is one of negativity. Accentuate the positive, and you are more likely to see a positive outcome. If you follow these 8 action steps, not only you will be a better leader, but also lead yourself to a more successful life. Number 2, most people in life are happy to follow the lead of other people, to sit on the fence in a debate, or have the attitude of hiding at the back of the class. The most successful people are leaders and make things happen for themselves by taking a positive attitude and through working very hard to reach their goals. We are all able to become leaders, and this article may help you to achieve this status. I grew up as a very nervous person, who had very little self-confidence and who was very shy. I was not happy being this way and often felt jealous of other people who were happy to speak up and take control of tasks and situations. I wanted to be one of these leaders and not the follower that I certainly had become. In my early 20s, I decided that the time had arrived to make a series of life-changing decisions. I was determined to have a happy and successful life and was aware that I needed to change my whole attitude and approach to life. I was not happy at where I worked and joined an employment agency in an attempt to find alternative employment. In the reception area of the agency, I started speaking to a man who was also there hoping to find a different job. His name was Mark, and we got on well and wished each other the best of luck in our quest to find work. We even exchanged phone numbers and vowed to keep each other up to date with our progress. I was then interviewed by a man who explained his plan to help me to find this new role of work. He was very bright, clever and positive, and had many interesting ideas. He seemed very confident that I would soon be employed for a different company more suited to the skills which I had. At one stage of the meeting, he described the scenario of a group interview. He suggested that we may be ushered into a large room with a big table. As we sat down, there would be a sheet of paper asking the group to debate a particular subject. He stated that all of the people in the room would be in the same position, all looking for work, all nervous, however that in that room I could be whoever I wanted to be. He said that I needed to stand up and take the lead by stating that I would act as chairman, and that if anyone had a comment that they wanted to make, that they could raise their hand. If I did this, I would show my prospective employer that I was a leader. I went home and thought about this and did not believe I had it in me to act in the way that he wanted me to, as I was not a leader. Later that evening, Mark phoned, and all he was talking about was the group interview scenario. He also stated that there was no way that he would be able to stand up either in the way that had been described. I did not have to ever attend a group interview, but Mark did. He surprised himself by carrying out the advice and stated that after he had said his initial statement about being the chairman, that he had never felt so powerful and in control. For the rest of the day, other members of the group had been regularly asking him questions as if he was some sort of team leader. He was very proud of himself, and I am happy to report that he was successful at that interview and is very happy in his new position. He has also taken the success and learning experience into his social life and states that he has never had a higher self-esteem. I am very pleased for him, as he is a genuine person who works very hard. He is also one of only a few friends that I can honestly say that I trust. I have taken inspiration from Mark and have entered into a career of helping people who stutter to achieve fluency. This is something which I really enjoy and which gives me a large amount of job satisfaction. I am also far more confident than I ever have been and have at last found happiness. In conclusion, we all have it in us to be a leader. We need to be brave and determined to take control and remember that all we can do in life is to try our best. We are only sure about living one life, so let's be happy and not accept second best. Be a leader in life, not a follower. Number 3. It is estimated that our brains receive information through our senses that result in some 4 billion neuron impulses per second. Of these 4 billion pieces of information, we are only consciously aware of about 2,000. That's only 0.00005%. It's happening to you right now. I bet, until I mention it now, that you are not aware of the feel of your clothes on your skin. Or, be aware of the noises in the background. Or, be aware of the object just inside of your peripheral vision. Until I mentioned them, you were paying your full attention to something else. If you had to be fully aware of all the information that you receive all of the time, you probably would be so overwhelmed that you wouldn't be able to function. The unwanted information is filtered out through a process of deletion, distortion, and generalization. This filtering process is driven largely by our beliefs of how things are at that time. Whilst this can be hugely helpful in avoiding our brains from exploding, it can lead us into making assumptions about given situations that might not serve us well. We can easily become victims of the vagueness that we accept as fact. To make matters worse, when we communicate with others, we pass on our assumptions, with the additional assumption that the recipient makes the same assumptions. Our assumptions create gaps in our communication that we expect the other person to fill with the same understanding. All too often, because of our assumptions, we do not deliver what was expected. Here are some examples of vagueness. What assumptions are you making when you interpret them? Go and increase morale in the team. Make sure that they fully appreciate our efforts. Spend more time on customer relations. Being a champion of clarity. First off, to be a champion of clarity, you have to recognize that communication is full of assumption. A champion of clarity recognizes the pitfalls of assumption both as a speaker and as a listener. As a listener, they are only too aware of the following phrase: the meaning of your communication is the response that you get. As such, a champion of clarity takes responsibility for ensuring that their communication is fully understood. As a listener, they recognize that they often interact with victims of vagueness, and they take steps to avoid relegation from a champion of clarity by ensuring that they fully understand the intention of the communication behind the words that they hear. Good ways of ensuring understanding is getting sensory cues that provide the evidence of the successful future desired outcome. In response to the vague statements above, a champion of clarity would ask something like, "And when I have increased morale in the team, what will let you know that it has been done well? What is it that will let them know that we put in effort in a way that should be recognized? And when we are spending more time on customer relations, what will you see and hear?" Number 4. The benefits of communication are evident from the least sophisticated creatures to the most advanced, as in humans. Perhaps, among the creatures especially endowed with the power of communication, humans make use of them more intensely and with a purpose that each speech made has had some effect on the people who hears them. Not only do humans use communication in everyday survival, but uses it for a variety of reasons. It is used to inspire and to deliver important messages in a well-structured and equally measured manner. Public speaking. In a recent survey, more than 90% among the 1,000 American individuals interviewed are afraid of hosting a speaking engagement. 20% of them have at least done such acts and never want to do it again, while 75% commented that there are people who are endowed with such skills and that public speaking should be reserved solely to them. In a monologue lecture, one has to inform, influence, and convince people. This can only be done through the use of speech that is well-crafted, revised, and edited. The above criteria can only be met if the speaker has a main purpose in mind, a tool to convey the very same purpose with a full consideration of the recipient audience. In order for your speech to become as effective as you want it to be, you have to consider the four elements of the above activity, and tailor activities and strategies that will effectively drive your audience into believing everything you have to say. Whom? Your audience is your best resource when considering in what manner you would want to conduct your speech. You should deliberately come up with a verbal address that is appropriate to your audience. Consider their age, level of education, place in the society, and your level of relationship with them. Ron Curtis, an experienced speech master, commented that your first and primary purpose of speaking is to communicate ideas that you think your listeners would like to hear. Something that they want to internalize and be part of their lives, and something which they can use for their daily living and gain rewards along the way. What? Your topic will provide you an effective idea and help you develop a talk which is most appropriate, timely, and equally relating to your listeners and spectators. Your topic can be as complicated as you want it to be, as long as your audience is aware of the main topic at hand. When, as you go along making your speech, you may want to ask yourself if the subject of your talk is timely or something which your audience could probably relate to. You do not want to explain the science behind Alzheimer's if you are talking to business folks who are looking for ways on how they can develop a procedure for managing their business and get warranted results. In a sense, one has to consider if one has the opportune time to talk about things to their audience that will make a direct impact on how they view the world and the concepts surrounding your topic. How, as today's world becomes a place for entertainment, people expect their speakers to be lively and use strategies that will arouse their interest and help them better understand the complexities by which your topic is founded. Dr. Stephen D. Boyd says that a 20 or 200 person audience is similar in terms of maintaining their interest on what you have to say. Speakers battle on the external factors which play in getting the attention of your listeners. Listeners expect their client speaker to speak with vigor, humor, vitality, confidence, and animation. This can be in the form of creating something catchy, like a surprising and unusual story, an unbelievable figure, and/or your personal experiences. If you are tired and emotionally stressed, your listeners can feel it. It is evident in your voice, in your actions, and the way you move your hands and body. You will be physically restricted and repressed and could hardly do more to stir excitement among your audience. While these and other factors affect the way you conduct your speech, it is important to follow several recommendations that will help you combat the consequences of your audience finding out your true physical state. Vary your pace of speaking. Pause to make a point. Demonstrate gesture that is relevant to the idea that you are trying to point out. Employ facial expressions. Make sensible and purposeful movements. Number 5. People who want to lose weight search for a magic program that will let them lose weight without changing how they eat or whether they exercise. Late-night infomercials tout systems that will turn you into a millionaire overnight. We crave magical solutions that are quick and easy and produce big results. Well, I haven't found any magic diet programs, and I never saw a get-rich-quick program that really worked, but I do know one magic thing you can do to improve your results as a leader. It doesn't require any special equipment. You don't have to take an expensive seminar. It won't take you a long time to learn. Here it is. Show up a lot. Sounds simple, right? How could something so simple possibly produce an improvement in your leadership? Show up a lot so your arrival won't be an event. If you only show up to deliver big news, the people who work for you will erect their defensive shields as soon as you appear on the horizon. Those defensive shields make communication tough. But if you show up a lot, then your appearance is just a normal part of how the world works. The shields stay down and communication can happen. Show up a lot to learn about your people. Reports and statistics won't get the job done. You need to see your people in action to understand them. Show up a lot and you'll learn all about what they do well and poorly. Show up a lot so your people can learn about you. The best way for them to do that is by seeing you in person. Show up a lot so you can tell people what's important. You should have crafted your one or two simple messages about the mission and your people's part in achieving it. Show up a lot and you get more opportunities to share those messages. Show up a lot so you can make small course corrections. Your life as a leader will be easier if you can make lots of small course corrections instead of a few big course corrections. Remember, most effective supervision happens in the cracks in the system. Show up a lot and you've got lots of opportunities to make things right. Show up a lot to learn about the real world. The real world doesn't come to you in your office, neatly formatted into reports. If you want to get an unfiltered look at reality, get out of your office and around the people who work for you. But how much is a lot? The best answer to that question is, more than you're doing right now. Make it a priority to get out among the people who work for you. Don't just swoop and then swoop out, either. To get benefits from showing up, you have to stay and watch and listen and communicate. You have to take every encounter with someone who works for you as an opportunity to communicate, coach, encourage, and correct. Don't expect instant trust. If you haven't been showing up much, your people will probably not trust you when you suddenly start acting different. It will take time for your behavior to change their expectations. Hang in there. The benefits are worth it. Showing up a lot is an easy concept to grasp, but you have to turn it into a habit. That takes time, a month at least, but probably more. And it takes effort and attention. In the beginning, you'll probably need to schedule your showing up time. Showing up a lot won't help you lose weight or turn you into a millionaire overnight. But it just might be the one magic behavior that will make you a better leader. Thank you for watching or listening this video, and remember to subscribe now. And share this video to all your friends and everybody.